We are live. This is take two. I'm with Emily Fletcher, the amazing, amazing meditation guru, holistic mama, author of the brand new book, Stress Less, Accomplish More. Super excited. There it is. Yay.
Glowing like an angel.
Yes, right. And I'm Dr. Elisa Song, holistic pediatrician and pediatric functional medicine expert. This is take two because we thought we were live before, and I'm hoping we're live now. So if you guys can hear us, see us, give us a thumbs up, a heart, let us know you're here. I'm checking my phone. Yes, a big heart. Let us know where you're from. What I would love to know from you guys is what questions you have about meditation. Tracy says, just got the book. Yay! I know. I'm in Colorado right now on vacation. Otherwise, I would have the book in my hot little hands because it just came out yesterday. We're going to talk all about it. So I cannot wait. So what we're going to do today is talk about mindfulness and meditation for mamas and for kids and really take a deep dive into how we can incorporate meditation as a daily practice in our lives. Because there are so many, I mean, the more research I do into the health benefits, it is incredible. The reduction in inflammation, you know, there's this pathway called the NF-kappa-beta pathway that is really linked with chronic inflammation and this surge of chronic illness in our kids. And meditation reduces that, right? Meditation helps our immune system fight viruses. It's not just a luxury, right? So what I really want us to learn together today is how to incorporate this essential form of health maintenance. I mean, I feel like if you could bottle up the benefits of meditation in a pill, I mean, that would be like the magic pill, right?
Yes. So, it's actually, we made our whole trailer for the book was around this idea. It's like, if there was a pill that gave you all of the benefits and all of the energy that meditation gave you, everyone would take it. It would be a $1 trillion product. But because it's not a pill, because it's not external, you have to actually close your eyes and sit with yourself and feel your feelings. People are like, nope, no thanks. I'll have some wine. I'll watch some TV. I'm not interested in sitting.
Yeah. Well, that is one of the hardest things, right? Because Beth writes here, how do you get kids excited about mindfulness? And we're going to talk about some of those tips, mm-hmm. right? Because the idea of sitting and being still for 20, 30 minutes, I mean, you're thinking, oh my gosh, how can a kid do that, right? Mm-hmm. And I just wrote a mindfulness article today on the Healthy Kids, Happy Kids website to really go through how do we get this as an easy, daily, practical thing that we can do with our kids that's not a chore, right? And you know, kids, it's amazing, right? Well, we'll go into that, right? But kids are amazing. I mean, they can get into this mindful state without even thinking about it. I mean, as grownups, we have so much more baggage going on that it's a lot harder for us to kind of clear our minds and really sit and practice mindfulness and meditation. Mm-hmm. Oh, great. So what I'd love to know from you guys too, where you're from, how old your kids are, if you guys already have a daily mindfulness meditation practice, and if not, what are your struggles and challenges with it? And what I'm going to do, actually, what I actually want to do right now, I'm going to share this with my friends. I'm going to share this on my groups, right? So share this with any mama that you guys know really need to hear this today. Okay. Yeah,
and I am a new mama. I have an 8-month-old son, which you might be hearing in the next room. So I feel like I have a little bit more authority to speak on this subject than I did a year ago.
Yes. Well, Jasper is awesome. So cute. So this is something too. You guys make sure that you tag your friends who really need this, because this is so important for all of us to really understand that mindfulness is not hard to do. It's just something that we have to practice, right? And we have to make a priority. It's like exercise. It's almost like you just have to schedule it, right? You just have to say, I'm gonna schedule meditation in the morning. I'm gonna schedule my workout, you know, in the afternoon, just like you wouldn't skip breakfast. I hope you wouldn't skip breakfast, right? You know, we want to make this a part of our daily routine. So let me guys tell you a little bit more about how amazing Emily is. And I got to know Emily through this kind of online group and actually an in-person group of health entrepreneurs, right? These amazing people who want to get incredible health information out to the world. And so I met Emily through my bless you. This is real life, right? This is live. There's no editing. So I am so honored to be here with Emily today and really share with you how incredible she is. share with you her work, and this is really her life's work. So if you're in New York, you are lucky enough to have Ziva meditation, right? That's Ziva, Ziva meditation right there, to really go to her beautiful space and learn from her and meditate with her. But even if you're not in New York, you know, we'll talk more about Emily's program, Ziva Meditation Online, because it's accessible to everyone. And her brand new book, hot off the presses, literally like yesterday, no, 2 days ago, 2 days ago, Stress Less, Accomplish More, Meditation for Extraordinary Performance, is really, it's a groundbreaking book to really make meditation accessible, not something kind of woo-woo. It's something really that we need to do. We all want to be our best, right? Whether we're, whether we're stay-at-home moms, whether we're busy professionals, whether we're, I mean, whatever we're doing, right? Students, we need to perform our best no matter what we do. And we want to feel good about how we're doing that. So I'm going to pin the link to Emily's book in the comments, because if you get her book now, you have these incredible bonuses. And I wrote down the bonuses that you get. I have them in my inbox and I can't wait to enjoy them, because you literally get to experience the first few days of Ziva Online, and you get 9 guided meditation exercises, and you really get a sneak peek at Emily's day in her life, right, of a meditation guru. So Emily is the founder of Ziva, the creator of the Ziva technique, and regarded as a leading expert in meditation for high performance. Her debut book, Stress Less, Accomplish More, was published by HarperCollins on February 19, 2019, so just this week. The Ziva technique is a powerful trifecta of mindfulness, meditation, and manifesting designed to unlock your full potential. Its benefits include decreased stress, deeper sleep, improved immune function, increased productivity, and extraordinary performance. The New York Times, the Today Show, Vogue, and ABC News have all featured Emily's work. She's been named one of the top 100 women in wellness to watch, has taught more than 15,000 students around the world, and has spoken on meditation for performance at Google, Harvard Business School, Viacom, and Wanderlust. Ziva graduates include Oscar, Grammy, Tony, and Emmy Award winners, NBA players, Navy SEALs, Fortune 500 CEOs, busy parents, right, and social entrepreneurs. So we have so much to learn from Emily today. So let's get started. So I actually, Emily, had a question for you. I'm just wondering, how did you come to meditation, or how did meditation come to you? And was this something that you grew up with, and was this something natural to you, or did it have to find its way to you?
It definitely found its way to me. I grew up in Tallahassee, Florida, which is about 7 minutes from the Georgia line. So it's very Southern. I was raised Southern Baptist. So needless to say, there was no meditation happening in my house. And it wasn't until I moved to New York, I was on Broadway for 10 years. And my last Broadway show was a chorus line, and my job was to understudy 3 of the lead roles, which means you have no idea which character you're going to play each night when you show up to work. Some people are good at this job. I'm not one of them. I was living my life in this constant state of fight or flight. I was in this constant anxiety, and that anxiety started leading to insomnia. I could not sleep through the night for 18 months, and I'm sure every parent on here knows that insomnia, sleeplessness, being tired, it's hard. Life is hard when you're tired, and yeah. You know, especially when your voice and your body are your instrument, and then the worse my sleep was, the worse my performance was, which only made my anxiety worse. And I was on this downward spiral. I started going gray at 26, started getting sick and injured. And finally, I was like, wait, why am I living my dream? Why am I doing the thing I wanted to do since I was a child, but I'm miserable? And so thankfully, I found meditation. And on the first day of my first class, I slept through the night for the first time in 18 months. And I have every night since. That was 11 years ago. I stopped going gray. I'm going to be 40 next month. I have like one gray hair. I was definitely going gray a decade ago. I didn't get sick for 8.5 years, not even a cold, for 8.5 years. And then most importantly, I started enjoying my job again. And so I thought, why does everyone not do this? Left Broadway, went to India, and started what became a 3-year training process to teach this. And since I graduated, I opened up Ziva in person, and then I created the world's first online meditation training, and then did all those amazing things you just shared. And it's just been such a gift and such a joy to be able to help share this practice that has healed me and helped me so much, but now be able to share it with others. And now with this book, to really make it mainstream and affordable and get these tools into the hands of people who need it the most. And I would say parents fall very, very high in that category. Yeah. And like I said, I have an 8-month-old, and I know now how intense it is. It is such a gift, and it's so rewarding, but there's a cost to it. You know, there's things, it's like a, I do think there's the return on investment is higher. You get more reward, but it's intense. And so the better you're taking care of yourself, the more you have to give to your family and to your kids.
Absolutely. Well, and you know, one thing that really struck me as I was really looking into helping define what mindfulness is for mm-hmm. parents is there's this research study out of Harvard that showed that less than half the time, I think it was maybe 46% of the time, are we actually thinking about what we're doing while we're doing it. Majority of the time, our mind is somewhere else, right? We're thinking about anything but what's right here in front of us and what we're doing. Even if it's something enjoyable, like sitting and going, you know, sitting and reading a book with your daughter, right?
Or having sex or something, you know?
Exactly.
I have to put the kids to bed and
right. I mean, we're thinking about all the 20 different things we have to do. Mm-hmm. And really that sort of mind wandering, it's called, and that multitasking that we're doing, it just makes everything less efficient, less pleasurable, right? And it causes stress. So this is where really honing in, understanding how to, you know, be mindful in our everyday. And that starts with a meditation practice. And I will say, you know, meditation has kind of come and gone for me. And we're going to talk about how to make it a priority, because we need to make this a priority, and I need to make this a priority, not just for me, but also for Kenzie and Bodhi and for Peter, right? Because relationships suffer when you're not taking care of yourself. But it's really, when you practice meditation and you search for a guide, you want to have a guide who you resonate with, right? Mm-hmm. And just listen to Emily's voice. I mean, like, who wouldn't just want to close their eyes and meditate with Emily all day long, right? I mean, mesmerizing. I mean, just get, you know, download some of her free guided meditations, right? When you get her book, you get those free guided meditations. And I mean, it's beautiful, right? I mean, it's just amazing, because I think one of the reasons I've fallen off is because some of the apps that I've used, I just haven't liked their voices, right? And when you can't listen, it's like having a yoga instructor where you're just trying to sit there for 90 minutes doing yoga and just not able to connect with their voice. So.
Yeah. Well, I think it's interesting because I get a lot of feedback of like, oh, you have the best voice. And wow, thank you. And I've been singing my whole life, so I'm sure that's part of it. I think it's more of a resonance, like you said. It's like an energetic match. Either you resonate with that person or not. And that the voice is the transmitter of that consciousness. It's the transmitter of that energy. Yeah. So you know pretty quickly what state of consciousness people are in, if it's like a right vibe or time for you to work with that person. Mm-hmm. And so while I do try to make my voice, you know, as enjoyable as possible, what I'm really interested in doing is making people self-sufficient. So when people read the book or when they take the classes, it's like they get the keys to the car, they get the driving instructions, and then you have this tool, this technique to take with you for life, and you don't need me, you don't need my voice. It's nice to use as training wheels, but eventually I want people to do this on a plane, on a train, on a bus, at work, with kids screaming next room, like just anywhere you need to, you just close your eyes and you have the ability to go inward. That's which is great. Much better than like, is my phone charged? Do I have headphones? Is there Wi-Fi? Oh, I can't, my phone's dying. I can't. But you know, just close your eyes and dive in.
Yeah. So
I like to make people self-sufficient meditators.
I love it. And you know, one of the things that really I think people seek meditation out for is when they are stressed, right? And or their physician or the practitioner might say, you know, I really think that you should start meditating. And that's something, oh, you know, as a practitioner, I find really challenging, because so many practitioners now are aware of the power of meditation to heal and support the immune system and support the nervous system, but don't know how to do it, right? Don't know how to really teach, give patients the tools to go out and do it, mm-hmm. right? So that's where I love that your book and your online program makes that accessible to everyone, even if the practitioners don't really know, you know, where to send them, right? Or you don't have some place to go that's in your town. So when we're stressed, you know, most of us have some sort of a way that we deal with stress. And a lot of it includes really distraction, right? Whether it's drinking a glass of wine, which I definitely have been known to do, you know, at night, or maybe exercising, you know, sometimes a little too much, right? Or going shopping, or, you know, whatever it is, right? So how can we look at meditation as an even better form of stress relief for us?
Yeah, thanks for asking that. Because some people will say, you know, Emily, exercise is my meditation, or cooking is my meditation, or mountain biking is my meditation. And those things are all beautiful, but exercise is called exercise, and cooking is called cooking, and meditation is called meditation. That's, you know, they're different things. That's why they have their own words. And so to look at this really simply, with exercise, you're exciting the nervous system. In meditation, you're de-exciting the nervous system. So they're really fundamentally quite different. What people are saying there is that exercise relaxes me, mountain biking relaxes me. And maybe you get into a meditative state when you're doing those things, but it is not the same thing as meditation. And the really important distinction here is that exercise is good enough to deal with your stress in the now. Like, so my boss yelled at me, I go to the gym and I get on the treadmill and I run it off, or I box it out. And so that's like left over from this sort of fight or flight stress reaction. So when we get stressed, the body involuntarily launches into a fight or flight stress reaction and preparing for a predatory attack. Yeah. So this is why people say, well, exercise is my meditation, because you can go to the gym and you can outrun that tiger, you can box that tiger, but that's only going to deal with today's stress. If you want to handle the dog that barked in your face when you were 10, or your parents divorced when you were 12, or the college you got kicked out of, all that stuff that has been stored in our cellular, and now we know epigenetic memories, we have to actually give the body rest. And what's interesting and then unique about Ziva is that at Ziva, we teach a trifecta of mindfulness, meditation, and manifesting. And I'll talk more in a moment about the difference between mindfulness and meditation, but the meditation that we teach is all about de-exciting the nervous system. It's giving the body rest that's five times deeper than sleep. And when you do that, when you give your body the rest that it needs, it knows how to heal itself. And one of the things that it heals itself from is stress. But interestingly, not just the stress from today, you're actually getting rid of all that stress from the past. And that is ultimately the thing that allows us to perform at the top of our game, because that accumulated stresses over time slows us down mentally and physically. And as we do the work, the discipline of getting to the chair every day, it's like we're sloughing off that old skin. It's like we're defragging our brain computer so that it can start to function as it was designed. So you start to find that you're able to do more in less time. You are, in fact, stressing less and accomplishing more.
I love that. And you know what, one thing that you said that is so important that I want people to really hear again is that really our emotions and our stress from when we were infants, even in utero, right? We carry that with us at a cellular level, right? That's that kind of cellular memory of our emotions and our stress, that epigenetic memory that Emily mentioned. And so you can't just get rid of that, as Emily said, with a glass of wine, or, you know, a run on the treadmill, or, you know, a shopping spree, right? You know, we need to do deeper work. And that's where meditation is, that deeper work. And it's so profound and, you know, so powerful. So I love that, you know, you define meditation in that way, right? That kind of 5x healing that occurs, right? You know, more than sleep itself. And you mentioned that mindfulness is different than meditation, right? Can you define them? Because I think a lot of people have in mind that mindfulness is meditation. Mm-hmm. And of course, you are mindful when you meditate, but what is the difference? How would you define mindfulness?
Yeah, so thank you for asking that, because I think it's a really important distinction, because it can be confusing if you're just starting out. Because a lot of people are using these terms as synonyms, and a lot of the apps out there are called meditation apps, but I would actually call them mindfulness apps. Mm-hmm. So as far as I'm defining it, I would define mindfulness as the art of bringing your awareness into the present moment. So beautiful, powerful, necessary, especially in relationship to the article that you shared today. The art of bringing your awareness into the present moment. And I think in this day and age, we've all become bulimic of the brain, and we're just intaking social media all day. Yep. Just be present, to be here and now is so powerful. But the big distinction here is that mindfulness is very good at dealing with your stress in the now. Meditation is getting rid of your stress from the past. Mm. And the way that the techniques are different is that in mindfulness, you are directing your focus. So anytime you're counting your breath or doing a guided visualization or picturing something in your body, that's all more active, and you're directing your focus, and a small part of the brain lights up, but very, very bright. Now, this is different than in the type of meditation that I teach in the book. In Stress Less, Accomplish More, I teach what I like to call the lazy man's meditation, because it feels kind of like a nap sitting up, and the whole brain lights up. And it's much less effortful. Like, you're not using much effort. It's very surrendered. It's very gentle. And that is where you're getting that deep healing rest. So mindfulness, good at dealing with your stress in the now. meditation, getting rid of your stress from the past. Also in mindfulness, you're directing your focus versus the type of meditation that I teach at Ziva. It's all about letting go. It's all about surrender. It's all about effortlessness.
I love that. The more we can have things be effortless, the better, right?
Yes, exactly. There's plenty enough effort being a parent.
That's right. So you mentioned with Ziva, right? You teach mindfulness, mm-hmm. meditation, and manifesting. So what is the manifesting part?
Okay, so that's like the dessert portion of the Ziva. And it's a little advanced, but it's not complicated. I would define manifesting as consciously creating a life you love. Mm. And that sounds simple because it is, but I'm constantly surprised and a little amazed at how rarely people take the time to do that, to really design their lives, to ask questions like, how much money do I want to make this year? What's my ideal number of hours spending time with my kids? What's my dream vacation look like? How many times a week or a month do I want to be having sex? You know, what's my dream house look like? You know, instead we ask questions like, why did she get a raise and I didn't? When am I going to lose this weight? Why won't my kids sleep through the night? And if you ask terrible questions, you're going to get terrible answers. Yeah. So it's basically just training people to ask better questions and using that sacred time at the end of meditation where the right and left hemispheres of your brain are functioning in unison. This is a very powerful time to manifest because you've got that left brain critical mind individuality talking to that right brain creative mind totality. And so to manifest from that space is very powerful. And here's the secret sauce. So spoiler alert.
We love the secret sauce.
Yeah, the secret sauce is I'll cut to the chase. And that the trick with manifesting is simply imagining your dreams as if they're happening now, right now. So you just, it's like you're playing pretend, like a little kid playing pretend, and you just visualize the dream as if it's unfolding around you in the now. Versus, again, what most of us do is that when we think we're manifesting, we're secretly complaining. We're like, when am I going to get a boyfriend? Why won't my kids sleep through the night? When am I going to lose this baby weight? And it's like we accidentally worship the space between where we are and where we think we should be. And that is the definition of stress. The space between where you are and where you think you should be. So we don't want to worship that. We don't want to put our attention on that. Instead, we want to water the flowers. We want to put our attention on the things that we want to grow in our lives. What does my dream relationship look like? What would it look like if I was compassionate and present with my kids? What would be our best family vacation? You know, and then it feels a little like magic, but it's not magic. It's just using the power of our minds.
Yeah. And you know, what I love about this is that, you know, for children in a way, you know, there's a question Beth asked, you know, to how do we get kids excited about mindfulness and meditation and all of this, but children are amazing. I mean, their minds can instantly get into a mindful state if we allow them to slow down, right? Mm-hmm. If we show them how to slow down. Mm-hmm. And that's where, you know, one of the things that we want to do for kids is just really make it more of a game, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, some of these apps that really get kids into that mindfulness, which I agree, they're more mindfulness, not so much meditation for kids, but they're stories, right? I mean, it's just telling a story and kids can just, they don't have to close their eyes and sit in lotus position and, you know, take a long time. I mean, they're like instantly there.
Right? Yes.
So then if we can learn these tools for ourselves, mm-hmm. help guide our kids to have those tools from the time that they're young. I mean, oh my gosh. I mean, the reduction in inflammation and illness and the huge increase in health and well-being and happiness would be huge.
Yeah. And I think what you said, two things that are so spot on that you just said, one, that kids are so much faster at it than we are. And two, if you can do it for yourself, you know, I have so many parents coming to me saying like, how can I get my kids to meditate? How can I get my kids to meditate? I'm like, okay, are you meditating? And then the answer is no. It's like, well, that's step one. You got to clean your own house. Because as you well know, kids are so energetically sensitive. They're picking up on what you're doing, how you're feeling, much more than what you're saying. And there's two really beautiful benefits of you meditating yourself. One is that it just changes the energy of the house. It changes the energy in the room when you're happy, when you're present, when you're rested, when you're not bringing in the stress from the day or the stress from your whole lifetime into dinner time with you. that really will help their anxiety tremendously. But the other sort of surprise benefit that I've been noticing as my students will share feedback is that as your kids see you taking accountability and responsibility for your own mental hygiene, they stop taking responsibility for it themselves. Because kids are narcissistic. You know, they think, well, if mommy's mad, it's my fault. If daddy's sad, I did something wrong. Like, we can't help but internalize it because we think the whole universe revolves around us when we're that age. And so if they see you taking accountability for your own happiness, then if you're in a bad mood one day, they'll say, mommy, did you meditate? And they know that it's, well, that's not on me. She didn't meditate. It's not my fault. And so then they actually start to keep you accountable, which I love. And then one other kind of pro tip that I share with my parents is, you know, tell your kids that you're meditating, you know, let them in on the secret. And what I like to say is tell them that you're in Jedi training. Like, mommy, training to be a Jedi. Yep. So don't interrupt her. If there's bones or blood, please interrupt mommy. If there's no bones or no blood, that it can wait the 7 minutes that I have left. And that takes a couple of days. You know, they're going to try and get your attention. Mom, 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 mom. But again, no bones, no blood. You just keep your eyes closed. And then in a couple of days, they'll actually start to protect it for you.
Yeah. Yeah. So tell me, you know, when we talk about a meditation practice, and I know one of the things that, one of the obstacles that a lot of moms have sort of internally is, and externally, is this idea that meditation takes a long time, that they don't have time for it. How are they going to fit it into their schedules? So what would you say to a mom who feels like, gosh, their plate is already so full. I know this is going to be good for me, but I just don't think I have the time for it.
Yeah. So this is a big, big issue for everyone, but especially busy moms. And there's a couple of factors here. One is if you're doing a technique where you're not getting a return on your time investment, then of course you don't have time for that, right? Like if you're doing 10 minutes of a free app and you feel okay on the other side, but it's not really helping you produce more or be more productive, if it's not making an impact in your sleep, then no, you probably don't have time for that. But if you're doing a practice where you're getting a return on your investment and your sleep is better and your sex is better and you're more creative and your health is better and you're more present with your kids and your to-do list that used to take you 5 hours starts to take you three, then it becomes a no-brainer. It's like, oh, I can't not meditate. Like at this launch party 2 days ago, Dr. Mark Hyman, he wrote the foreword to the book, and he's, you know, 11-time New York Times bestselling author, has kids, is, you know, director of Functional Medicine Center at Cleveland Clinic. And, you know, he's busy, right? And he says, I don't have time not to meditate. Yeah. And if you look at the world's high performers, the Oprah Winfreys, the Ray Dalios, they all start their day with meditation. And that's not because they have copious amounts of extra time. That's because they know that it actually allows them to accomplish more in less time. And where this gets tricky is that when you're stressed and when you're overwhelmed and when you're not sleeping, you're just not performing at the pace at which you could. So everything feels overwhelming. And the thought of adding in one more thing seems inconceivable. So in Ziva and in the book, what I do is that we start really slow, right? We build up, we start with 5 minutes, we go to seven, then we go to 10. And then ultimately you graduate with a 15-minute twice a day practice. And I know that even that can seem like insurmountable, but hear me when I say this, you guys, I just went through this. I actually stopped meditating for my first month after having Jasper when I was postpartum. I had a brutal postpartum period. Yeah. You very kindly helped me through that. So it's not about having a perfect meditation record. It's not about being perfect. And I did take a break because it was almost like my body needed to be in fight or flight to get through the intensity that was that postpartum. But when I started back, it was like everything got easier. My sleep got better. My healing happened faster. I was able to mentally get back in the saddle to go back to work. And so it just, I just now know very recently the difference between being off and being on the wagon. Yeah. Yeah. And life really is so much easier when you do it. And the other just big thing, and this is one of the big points in the book, is that stress is making us stupid, sick, and slow. Just period, the end. Yeah. There's research coming out from Harvard Medical School suggesting that stress is responsible for 90% of all doctor's visits.
Yeah.
So saying you don't have time to meditate is like saying that you have time to be stupid, sick, and slow. And no, nobody has time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that.
No. And a busy mama definitely doesn't have time for that. So.
Yes.
So I'm curious, you know, when we think about using meditation and really getting to a space to relieve our stress, not just in the short term, but in the long term. And of course, you know, in that postpartum period, there's so much stress from, you know, feeding your baby enough to not sleeping because you just can't, you know, if the baby's up crying all night, to really trying to figure out how to, I mean, you're the last priority as a mama, right? I mean, everything is about this new world that's kind of been shoved at you, literally, you know, and oftentimes without much preparation. And so when you resumed your meditation practice, did you notice any shifts that occurred, you know, with Jasper and you know, your interactions with Jasper?
Yes. I went from being like tired and crazy and sad to being like, you know, happy and present and able to sleep again. And the big thing I want to share here is, you know, in the book and in my classes, you know, I teach what I would consider like perfect, right? Which would be 15 minutes in the morning and 15 minutes in the afternoon. But the other big, big permission slip that I give to new parents is don't let perfect be the enemy of good. Mm-hmm. Don't let good be the enemy of done. You know, so ideally we're doing this in the morning before coffee, breakfast, or computer. But for a lot of folks, it's like their kids wake them up and then the day is just nuts. And then their day sort of starts when the kids go to school or if so you have some help coming over. So if your first meditation happens at 10 in the morning when your kids are at school and you've been up since 6, it's not ideal, but it's way better than not doing it, you know, or let's say your second meditation ideally would happen somewhere, you know, afternoon, evening before dinner. But if it's just a crazy day and you can't do it until after your kids go to bed, who cares? It's like, you just do it. And I would do it. Sometimes it would be 10 minutes. Sometimes I would do it while I was nursing once the pain went away. So it's just, don't let perfect be the enemy of good. You just fit it in wherever you can. You can be much more lax about the rules when you're a new parent. For me, I just felt, everything got easier when I started back. Mm.
So how long, you know, for someone who's starting out in meditation and really trying to really embrace the Ziva philosophy, right? The Ziva technique of mindfulness, meditation, and manifesting. How long would you say it would take to really start noticing and feeling some of the benefits, right? To get that kind of motivation to say, okay, I'm going to keep doing this.
I mean, really, usually a couple of days. Most people, especially with the online course and with the live course, it's day one, day two. I would say day four of the online course, because that's when they start the meditation portion. The first 3 days are mindfulness, which is more akin to what's available out there, the apps and the YouTube videos. But once you get to day four and you start the meditation, people are like, whoa, that's different. I'm in a different state of consciousness than I've ever been in before. You know, right and left hemispheres of the brain start functioning in unison. That's where you're getting that deep healing rest. So, and in my live course, it's like usually day one, day two, it's sort of like, this is different. And then something I want to just give a little warning, it's a little caution, a little caveat, is that for a lot of folks, in the first few weeks, there can be a bit of an emotional and physical detoxification that can happen. So just like when we started this conversation, we were talking about all of that stress and trauma that can get stored in our cellular memory. So even if you've been doing therapy for decades and healed things on the cognitive level, what this is doing is that it's healing things on the cellular level. And oftentimes there can be a bit of a purge, a bit of a healing catharsis. And that's a big part of why I recommend having a teacher and a community. And anyone that reads the book, they can join our Facebook group. So they have an online community. I'm in there. The other Ziva teachers are in there. There's longtime meditators that are in there to support you, because it can be kind of scary, you know, to have an upwelling of sadness or an upwelling of anxiety coming up and out. And part of my job as a teacher is to just let people know what's normal and what is to be expected with that purge. And really what I recommend to get through it is resting, you know, just resting and feeling it. And I know you had Dr. Joan Rosenberg on recently and her tips and tools of feeling it, just sitting in those emotions and letting them come up and out really is the whole trick to moving through that detox process.
So I would say, you know, for the mamas listening, you know, and as, you know, as they ask you, Emily, and ask me, well, how can I get my kids to meditate and be mindful? You know, because it can be so powerful, I really do think that experiencing it yourself first, right, would be so important. And again, I mean, kids don't have, fortunately, most kids don't have as much of that emotional kind of cellular memory to release, but they're can be a release. And so making sure that we understand what that is and identifying that so that we can help our kids identify things that are coming up as they come up too is so helpful.
And one fun thing I recommend with kids is, because we do a kids course at Ziva in person twice a year, and I'm not an expert in kids meditation. I wish that I was. I think there's a huge, huge need for more kids meditation programs. I think you and I might collaborate on something.
Oh, that'd be so amazing.
But I recommend that they, like, once you have the hang of it, and once you feel solid in your practice, if they come to you and if your kids ask you questions, I would say include them in it. Be like, you know, do you want to sit with me for a few minutes? Now, if you're doing 15 or 20 minutes, do not ask your kids to do that out of the gate.
Yeah.
But if they're 5 years old, maybe they sit for 5 minutes. And if they're six, maybe they sit for 6 minutes. And so what I do is with kids, I have them on each birthday, they add a minute to their meditation. And so it's fun because it feels like a reward, or that they're graduating into something versus a punishment. And then, you know, I, like I said earlier, I teach 15 and 15, but with kids, you don't have to be so disciplined. It doesn't have to be twice a day. It doesn't even have to be every day. It doesn't have to be in the morning. What I found is that they're very creative and intuitive about when and how they want and need to use it. But I just think it's such a powerful gift to let them see that you can go inward for your happiness, that you can turn inward for your bliss instead of constantly seeking it externally. You know, most of us as humans are so eyeball deep in what I call the I'll be happy when syndrome.
Yep.
When I have a kid, when this kid stops breastfeeding, when the kid goes into school, when the kid graduates, when the kid comes home. It's like we just, our happiness gets further and further away. And what meditation does, it allows you to experience your happiness right here, right now.
Yeah.
And I would say of all the gifts that meditation has given me, well, the first was curing my insomnia. But now that I have a kid, I would say the gift of being so hyper-present with him, he's changing so quickly. From the time I put him to sleep at night to when he wakes up in the morning, he's a different kid. He's taller and smarter so and true. Bigger and faster. I'm like, what happened?
And so it's, true.
It's so easy to even panic about that. Of like, I'm missing it. And I find that with the meditation, I have the ability to just get hyper-present with him and just watch it all unfold. Watch him as he's discovering things and really find that joy, that bliss of being hyper-present. And I'm not sure that I would have that ability if I didn't have this practice.
I love that so much, Emily, because I think as moms, what we struggle with is because we are typically the caretakers for the entire family, you know, let alone ourselves. And top of that, we may be working and we may be, whether it's at school volunteering or in the office or whatever it is, it's so hard to stay mindful in that moment. And if meditation can help with that, you know, how much more joy could you have with your kids? I mean, I often lament to Peter, oh, I just want more time with the kids. And it's not that it's more time, because really it's valuing the time that I have with them, right? And one thing that I find myself doing, and I kick myself over and over again when I do this, and I'm trying not to, but you know, even let's say I have a Saturday morning with the kids and we're going swimming, or you know, we have time to go for a walk, and even in that moment where I should be enjoying every single bit of this, soaking in, you know, everything they're saying and the touches and the hugs and the kisses and the what's going on around me and in between us, you know, with us and for us, I'm thinking about what I'm going to do when the walk is done, right? And how many of us do that? You know, we think, oh, I just want a special date, you know, a date night with my daughter or with my son. But every night could be a date night if you just really paid attention to every moment you have. And you know, if meditation can do that for you in those 15 minutes a day or 30 minutes a day, I mean, how much more time would you feel like you actually have with your children, because you would be present for all of it?
Yeah. I would say it's not quantity. It's really quality.
No, it's not. It's
after totally like your 6 hour of like solo mom duty, you're like, I need a break. You had like 3 quality hours, so much more enjoyable. Yeah. And to your point, I think one, just sort of, if we wanted to give ourselves like an affirmation or something to write on the wall, it's you can't pour from an empty cup. Right. And so sometimes we get into this cycle and this rat wheel of like, well, my kids need me and my job needs me and my husband needs me and I don't have time and I don't have time. We get into this martyrdom a little bit. But I would argue that your kids don't need you sick, tired, and stressed.
Yeah.
Your partner does not want you sick, tired, and stressed. They want you happy. They want you present. They want you creative. And they're that old cliche of like happy wife, happy life. You know, the happier you are, the happier your whole house is going to be. And I've just seen this happen thousands of times over. People go from thinking, I don't have time, my life is crazy. But if they take 2% of their day, which P.S. that's what it is, 15 minutes twice a day, that's 2% of your 24-hour day. Are you willing to make a 2% investment so that the other 98% of your life can be more amazing?
Yeah.
And when you look at it like that, you're like, of course I am. Mm-hmm. And the other trick is I would say check your moments, your screen time. You know how iPhone is now giving you your weekly screen time, your average hours a day. Just look at that. And if you're above 5 hours on your phone a day, you have time to meditate.
That's right. Oh my gosh, such a great tip. I love that. You know, I haven't done that for myself. I'm a little nervous too, but
it's terrifying. But it's a real honesty check. We were like, wait, I spent how long on Instagram? Yeah. Like, yeah. I'm gonna up my meditation.
That's right. Okay, so tell us, walk us through Stress Less, Accomplish More, right? Yes. Which is the link to the book is pinned on the comment. But I'm so excited about this book because so many people don't really understand what meditation is and really don't have a clue as to how they're going to incorporate it as a practical daily exercise. Yeah. So walk us through how Stress Less, Accomplish More can help us do that.
Yeah. So in it, it actually teaches you the mindfulness, the meditation, and the manifesting. So that by the time you read it, you're going to graduate, finish reading the book with these tools to take with you for life. It's not just a book that's talking about all the magical benefits of meditation and not giving you any tools to get there. It actually gives you the tools. And so I wrote the book in three parts. Part one is all of the science and neuroscience behind what I call the selfish reasons that people come to meditation. So there's a chapter on why it can help you improve your sex life. There's a chapter on why it can improve the depth and quality and efficiency of your sleep, which Cliff's notes on that is that if you're using your meditation as a time for stress release, your body can use your sleep as a time for sleep. So you actually, it becomes more efficient, so you need less of it. So for a 30-minute investment of meditation in the day, you might shave off an hour or two of sleep that you need at night. So you're already in the black. You know, you already have more time in your day if that was the only thing it did for you. There's a whole chapter on how it can reverse your body age by somewhere between 8 and 15 years. And that's based on the new studies coming out about telomeres, you know, which are the gaps at the end of our DNA strands, which stress can unravel those and weaken your telomeres. So there's a chapter on how it can actually make you more money. And I wrote this book, to be quite honest, to be like a Trojan horse. I'm taking the very powerful medicine that is meditation and wrapping it in the candy coating that is, hey, you're going to have better sex and make more money. When people say they're too busy to meditate, what they're saying is I'm prioritizing things that make me money. So it's like, okay, well, what if there was a tool that could actually help you make more money? Oh yeah. And you're going to be a lot nicer on the other side and you're going to enjoy your life more. Like it just becomes a no-brainer. And one of my goals at Ziva is to make it as rude to leave your house without meditating as it would be to leave your house without brushing your teeth. So part one is all the science, and there's like a chapter on each of those things I just mentioned. Part two, I actually teach you the technique so you have it for take with you for life. And then in part three, we pull the lens back and we look at the ripple effect. How does you selfishly improving yourself, how does that improve your relationship? How does that improve your family? Mm. How does that up-level your relationship with your coworkers? And then ultimately humanity itself. Because when we say like, oh God, the world is so stressed, the world is so crazy. It's like, well, okay, how stressed are you? How crazy are you feeling? You know, it's like we have to start with ourselves. We have to clean our own house. And the beautiful thing here that we sometimes forget is that as we heal ourselves, we help to heal the collective. We're not healing in a vacuum. And so I just find that, yes, selfishly, I want my students' lives to get better, but I'm interested in the ripple effect of what them improving themselves, how that's going to impact their schools, their communities, their offices.
Mm, that's beautiful. I mean, could you imagine too? I mean, every single person who's working with kids and for kids, right? Teachers, pediatricians, there's Lori, who's a pediatric OT listening, you know, all of us who work with children, if we could bring this to the work that we do with them, and then they could then bring that, you know, and to their parents, and we could all really have, like you said, this collective ripple effect on our communities and our society, which is so needed. I mean, we are so disconnected, you know, even as the internet and social media are seemingly connecting us more frequently, we're so disconnected personally, and children especially need to understand how important it is to not just be connected with their friends and their family, but connected with themselves, right? Because then that's where the true connections will build.
Yeah. And like you said, it, like the social media, it's a tool and it can be used for things like this, for us to connect and to share knowledge and to have really social experiences, but it can also be a drug. You know, it can take you away, and there's things like digital dementia and, you know, all the anxiety that is being produced from social media at a young age. And so this is a way to help balance some of that out, to help combat some of that.
I love that. This is going to be the book that I gift to every single one of my family members and friends.
Thank you.
So Stress Less, Accomplish More. You know what? I would be so honored, Emily, if you could share with us, as we're kind of wrapping up, a meditation that we can take with us for the rest of today and go back to tomorrow morning until we can get our hot little hands on your book.
Yes, I would love that. Thank you so much for inviting me. So actually, I'm going to do two things with you. One is called balancing breath. And this is kind of fun, and it could actually be a game you could play with your kids. And then we'll do something called come to your senses, which I think you could absolutely share with your kids as well. So the balancing breath is a great way to prime the brain and body for meditation. And in it, we're going to be closing the right and left nostrils, which helps to balance the right and left hemispheres of the brain. And the reason why I like this is that you can use it to kind of gear down or gear up, depending on how quickly you do it. So if you're just so tired and you were up all night the night before, it's something you can do really quickly to give you a boost. Or if you're feeling kind of nervous and amped and you need to just relax before bed or before a date or before bath time with your kids, you can do it slowly. Mm-hmm. And then the come to your senses is a mindfulness tool that's really about using your five senses to bring yourself into the now, into this moment. So to begin, let's take our right hand, and we'll take our thumb and our ring finger, and we'll close our right nostrils with our thumb.
And you know what I'm going to do, Emily? I'm going to actually turn off my video so it's just you, because nobody needs to be distracted by me.
Not that sexy, but I'm going to take one for the team.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. So let's, we'll take your right hand, we'll do your thumb and your ring finger. You can close your right nostril with your thumb and exhale through the left nostril. Really good. Inhale through the left. And then switching sides, closing your left nostril with your ring finger and exhaling through the right nostril. Good. Inhale through the right. And switching sides, closing the right nostril with the thumb and exhaling through the left nostril. When you get to the bottom of the exhale, just let yourself float in that tiny space between. And then as you inhale, let that breath just fall into the lungs, into the belly, taking the biggest inhale you've taken all day. When you get to the top of the inhale, take one more sip of air. Floating there at the top for just a moment, and then switching sides, let that breath fall out of the right nostril all the way to empty. And when you get to the bottom of that exhale, just floating there in that space between, you can close your eyes if you have not already, and then allowing that breath to fall into the lungs through the right nostril, biggest inhale you've taken all year. And you get to the top, one more sip of air, and then switching sides, exhaling through the left nostril all the way to empty. And on this next inhale, I invite you to imagine this breath and energy coming into the base of the spine. And as you fill your lungs with breath, imagine that energy traveling up the spine. When you get to the top of the inhale, switching sides, and imagine sending that breath and energy right out through the middle of your forehead. Really good. So on this next inhale, breathing into the base of the spine, filling the lungs, letting this breath and energy traveling all the way up the spine. And then exhaling, sending that creative energy that we just woke up at the base of the spine, sending that out into your life, out through your forehead. Good. So you can keep your eyes closed or drop your hands into your lap. And we'll move through a short but powerful mindfulness exercise called Come to Your Senses. So we'll begin by listening for all the sounds we can detect. The sound of my voice, the air conditioning or any heat happening in your surroundings. And this is a beautiful opportunity to pull the lens of our awareness out and include all of the sounds happening inside of this experience. So we're not judging the sounds as good or bad. They're not distractions. We're simply noticing what's the most prevalent sound I can detect right now. And what's the most subtle. And now ever so gently bringing your awareness to your sense of touch. So noticing, what's the most prevalent tactile sensation in your body right now? Feeling your bum in the chair, your clothes against your skin. And if it's comfortable for you, I invite you to sit with your back supported and your head free. So if you're seated in a chair, on a couch, you can just lean back, allowing your body to soften, allowing your muscles to relax. Noticing the most prevalent, and now the most subtle tactile sensation. Can you feel your muscles release? Can you feel the breath as it enters and exits the nostrils? And now, even with the eyes closed, I invite you to see what you're seeing. The prevalence of the blackness. The subtlety of the light streaming through your eyelids or any colors in your mind's eye. And now taste what you're tasting. Can you taste your lunch or your toothpaste? Noticing the prevalent and the subtle tastes, perhaps even the absence of taste. And finally, smell what you're smelling. Can you smell your own shampoo or any cooking happening? Really good. Now I invite you to play with holding all of your senses in your awareness at the same time. So hearing, feeling, seeing, tasting, and smelling. Giving yourself permission to be so deliciously human, so present in your body right here, right now. Knowing that the present moment is the future in the making. So the more we wake up our five senses, the more present we become right here, right now, the higher quality seeds we plant for the future. So moving through in your own time, hearing, feeling, seeing, tasting, and smelling. Knowing that it's through our five senses that we wake up our sixth sense of intuition. Including everything that's happening inside of this experience. Really good. And as we come up and out, I invite you to think of three things that you're most grateful for in this moment. It could be the sound of your child's laughter, the fact that you have food to eat tonight, that you have people who love you. Just three things that come to mind that you feel grateful for. Just saying thank you. Even on the days where you can't think of anything to be grateful for, just asking the question is enough to change the chemistry of your brain. And as you think of these three blessings, what if they bring a little smile to your face? Even if you have to fake it till you make it, just slap on a big old toothy Julia Roberts grin, and now inhale this smile into every single cell in your body. And then exhaling, letting go of anything that isn't serving you, anything you're ready to surrender. And one final time, big old smile, big old toothy grin. Breathe that smile into your liver, into your toes, into your feet, letting every single cell in your body vibrate with the frequency of gratitude and love. And as you exhale, letting go of anything that is not serving you in this moment. Really good. Giving yourself a big internal high five for tuning in today, giving yourself a big internal high five for taking this moment for yourself to fill yourself up from the very source so that you have more to give to your family, to your friends, to yourself. And in your own time, whenever you're ready, we can start to slowly, gently open the eyes. Good job. High five. We did it.
Oh my gosh. I don't want to open my eyes, but this is such a great way to start the rest of the day.
Yeah, and that's kind of what I see. It's like, especially if you do the meditation that mid-afternoon, early evening, it's like you hit reset on your day. You hit reset on your brain. You have a whole new energy to bring to dinner time, to bring to bath time, instead of just racing through it so that you can get to your wine. It's like, what if you reset, you know, and then enjoy dinner time, enjoy bath time, enjoy bringing creativity to that versus just rushing through it so you can get to bed.
Yeah. Well, and you know what I love about really everything we've spoken about, Emily, that we can see and feel what an amazing guide and teacher you are, but also that as the ultimate teacher, you will teach us how to do this for ourselves. I love that. I love that, because then we can really, no matter how stressed we are, wherever we are, even if it's in our car, just dreading the day, you know, and wanting to kind of sneak in our car for, stay in our car for maybe another 5-10 minutes. We can do this anywhere with the tools that you give us. So I'm so excited and so honored that you spent your afternoon here with us today, even as Jasper's calling you in the background.
I'm coming, buddy. I'm coming.
That's right. So I want to make sure that everybody knows about your incredible book, Stress Less, Accomplish More.
And some exciting news. We just found out we're number 35 out of all the books on Amazon, you guys. I'm That's freaking amazing. Out a little bit. And so I know that books are this thing where it's like not urgent. It's like, oh, I have so many books to read and I'll get around to that one. But as a personal favor, like if you don't think I'm a total ding dong and if you're like, oh, maybe I'll get it. If you wanted to get it before tomorrow evening, that would really help me a little. And the tools in this book, I know will help you and your family a whole lot. I know it because I've experienced it firsthand.
Oh, so
and
much.
Those bonuses that you mentioned, those go away on Saturday as well. So I know meditation is not urgent at all. So it's tricky to like, how do you put some urgency on like a practice that's thousands of years old? But here we are.
But I want you guys to have the bonuses too, because they're incredible. I mean, the bonuses are, you know, you get to experience the first 3 days of Ziva online, which, I mean, once you experience it, you're going to want the whole thing. That's Emily's online meditation training, right? And so you get all that, and then you'll get 9 guided exercises, right? Mm-hmm. Meditation exercises from the book. Mm-hmm. So you can listen to Emily's beautiful voice anytime you want. And then also a day in the life guide. So I'm going to put that link, because once you get the book, you can go to stresslessthebook.com to get your bonuses. And I was so excited to get my bonuses.
You're the best. Thank you for doing them.
Oh yeah. I'm going to share this with everyone. Tracy, you're so welcome. Stephanie Davis was on. Yay. So yes, I will be there, Stephanie, in August. So hopefully we will get together and we'll give each other big hugs, right?
Yes. Mind share hugs. Mama
so,
hugs.
Yes. So Emily, this was so great. I can't wait to share this with this recording, share your book with all of the mamas that really need this, right? I needed this today. So thank you so much. And I can't wait to hear the amazing things, the ripple effect that really comes from your work.
Thank you so much for having me. This has been a real delight. And thanks for everyone for tuning in.
Yeah. All right. Talk to you soon. Bye.